Oh, this is way too good a story and way too important a story to wait until Monday. I had to cover it tonight. But to be fair, Solo's opening weekend box office, as I'm sure some of you are typing down below right now, is a developing story. However, industry estimates are rarely far off at this stage. And right now, the trades are pegging Solo to hit 80 to 90 million for the 3-day and 105 to 115 million for the 4-day. The ramifications for this are huge and are far-reaching within Disney. And we are going to break it down right now. But first, I want to be clear. When I compare the new Star Wars to the DCEU, I'm not talking about the quality of the movies. As you know, those types of discussions I think are unfair, and I think they generate more negativity than they help the overall conversation, right? But what I'm talking about are the similarities from a business perspective, and the similarities are astounding and aplenty. I can't believe this has happened twice now. That's amazing that two studios would make the same mistake so close together. But what's even more shocking is that one of those studios is the up until now seemingly Teflon Disney. Oh, wow. I know there's going to be a lot of people are gunning for this to happen. Emotions are running high, and I'm sure emotions are pretty high within Disney right now, right? And particularly Lucasfilm. But I think we should remain, you know, as impartial as we can, right? And look at this from a scientific business perspective, because I'm sure no studio wants this to happen again, right? It would seem that no one could mess up as badly as the DCEU has, but yet here someone has. And again, you can see a pattern developing. It's actually, again, quite fascinating. No ill will towards anyone necessary for this to be an enjoyable conversation. All right, so I would like to point out also, speaking of goodwill, that I see a way forward for Star Wars just as I do for the DCEU. I haven't given up hope for either of them. And the video, I've prepared a video for what I think should happen next with Star Wars. It's locked and loaded and was gonna go up Saturday morning, but now to make room for this video, we'll go up Saturday afternoon, so look out for that. Now there's a lot to discuss here, so as you can see, chapter times are down below in the video description. But the first thing is that DCEU comparison. Now the Hollywood Reporter, as they, Deadline made the comparison themselves when they were covering this developing story of the opening weekend box office. If you're wondering what trades to keep an eye on, it's Deadline, Hollywood Reporter, and Variety. Those are the big three, and I think the most trustworthy. Now, they compared Solo's opening weekend to Justice League's, which wasn't a holiday weekend, but you know what? The numbers match. And as I tweeted, these are two movies where the bottom dramatically and suddenly, that's the key word, suddenly fell out from underneath the franchise. And I love the response. You guys, we had a fun time tweeting about this earlier this evening, but one of you in particular, I love this tweet from R. Kester, who said, this is largely a response, because, you know, going into the weekend, there was a call to boycott the film. And R. Kester points out that this was largely a response to how Lucasfilm, Kathleen Kennedy, and Ryan Johnson gave the middle finger to everyone who didn't like The Last Jedi. It was a, yeah, so what if you hated it? You'll pay to see the next one anyway, ha ha ha. And the fans were like, Mr. Bean does the honors, as you can see. Ah, good old Mr. Bean. Michael Scott are the kings of gifts, I feel. But I think that perfectly captures a situation, and we'll talk about Kathleen Kennedy's relationship with the fans a little bit later in this video. But yeah, the suits felt that these franchises were just too big to fail. And to be fair, for quite some time, that was the case. But with all the entertainment choices that are available these days, but also social media, putting fans together so that can reassure them that they aren't alone in their disappointment, and also the developing crusade, well, that means audiences have suddenly developed a backbone. And that's not good news for Hollywood. You know, the old divide and conquer. You didn't know how other people felt about the movies, right? They could put out a smokescreen, and oh, we're going to talk about smokescreens, because Disney had a big one for this one, and I think it seriously undercuts their credibility. But the next point I want to make is that some of you also tweeted me and said, does this mean that Kathleen Kennedy will quit or be fired on Monday morning or Tuesday? Because, of course, Monday's a holiday. just as Geoff Johns and John Berg had to step aside after Justice League. So I guess it's a fair question, but I don't think that this, you know, it's too soon, especially since this is her first loss. But I think she'll probably definitely get a stern talking to, right, from Bob Iger and the head of all Disney movies, Alan Horn. But she might also, I think, and this would be wise on Disney's part, to get a lieutenant, Dave Filoni, as the fans are begging. Now, I've come to the conclusion, I've been thinking about it for the past couple of weeks, and I feel that Kathleen Kennedy is not a Star Wars fan. And when she got this gig, you know, from her buddies, Steven Spielberg and George Lucas, who she's worked with for decades, she's really only worked with Steven Spielberg and her husband, Frank Marshall, who she met through working with Steven Spielberg. You know, she's really in a Steven Spielberg bubble there. Spielberg's made some mistakes too, to be fair. You know, he's in charge of the Transformers franchise. But anyway, back to Kathleen Kennedy. I think that instead of asking herself, why is Star Wars so popular, she asked, how can I make this something that appeals to me personally? And that was a fatal mistake, right? By the way, this has also been the DCEU's problem, and that is not having fans of the source material in charge. And you know, I don't even think that's entirely necessary. You could even have somebody who respects and tries to understand the source material and its popularity in charge, right? Instead of just shrugging their shoulders and going, I don't know why nobody likes this garbage, right? Let's try and make it something that we can work with. And you know, I think Julie Taymor actually had the same problem as well when she did Spider-Man Turn Off the Dark, which I think is very similar. And I saw the beauty in Spider-Man Turn Off the Dark, Batman v Superman, and The Last Jedi, right? But they're all very similar. And you can see they just don't work. Just, you know, the artistic aspects of them that are impressive, be damned. So I think that's, again, this is just so fascinating to see this, you know, this emergence. And there too, I think Julie Taymor was like, I don't get Spider-Man. What about Spider-Man appeals to me? That's what I'm going to focus on. I'm going to reshape it to make it something that I can work with. And it's like, well, you know, Julie, if you're not going to, meet the material halfway, maybe this isn't the project for you. And it turned out not to be the project for her, and it actually did ruin her career. Are Rian Johnson, you know, Zack Snyder was hurt by Batman v Superman, that was the DCEU, and we'll see what happens to Rian Johnson and Kathleen Kennedy. Haven't heard anything about his trilogy, have we? Wow. All right. Now, I also think that there's, by the way, Kevin Feige, of course, as we all know, huge Marvel fan. Now, I also think there's some chance that because of this, Episode 9 might not make its release date in order to go back to the drawing board and make sure that it's a home run or at least not a total disaster, that it begins to course correct. Now, also, speaking of directors, that's J.J. Abrams, of course, returning. Colin Trevorrow fired off that project. And speaking of firing directors, one of you tweeted me back during our discussion earlier tonight that both Justice League and Solo, the follow-ups to Batman v Superman and The Last Jedi, had the studios replace Maverick directors with seemingly safer directors. Now, who's to say if Snyder or Lord and Miller's versions would have had mass appeal, right? Because there were problems with, the way BVS and The Last Jedi were received. But anyway, perhaps they would have generated at least the kind of, let's say, crusader support that BVS still enjoys to this day. And while Justice League and Solo do have their casual supporters, I don't think anyone's going to go to the mat to defend them. But I would, and I believe many others would as well, go to the mat for The Last Jedi. Just as I do BVS, I really enjoyed both those movies. However, I do understand the mistakes that both made, particularly after hearing why detractors were so unhappy with those films. And on that note, it is not a bad thing, DCEU and Kathleen Kennedy, and the orchestra spoke to this, to listen to and acknowledge your fans. There's no shame in that. This, you know, obviously, as you can see, you have to work together. And I'd like to thank you guys, by the way, for remembering my BVS comparison to The Last Jedi when it was released. And this goes to show, by the way, that even the mass audience today now expects more intelligent and daring fare. I think, likely thanks to what the small screen is impressively and consistently putting out. To be fair, they cheat a little bit because they have more time and more space to do it, But yeah, they've definitely raised the bar quality-wise. And maybe as I've said before, the Marvel Cinematic Universe is like a very long television series almost. You know, the way all the stories are connected and they put out like 3 chapters a year. It's become very effective. And maybe that's something that if they want to have these big franchises, these other, they have to do that as well, where, the story, each story isn't a finite or enclosed story. You know, it's almost like Star Wars and the other franchises are doing the network television formula, right? Like there's an overarching story to the season, but each episode can stand alone if necessary. You have to go with the streaming strategy now, where it's just one fluid story, and that's what Marvel is doing so brilliantly, and I believe that's what other franchises will have to do as well. Now, I mentioned the trades, right? And remember that pre-sales story, which many of you were bringing up, that Solo had pre-sales that were double Black Panther, which led to a $170 million estimate for its opening weekend. And then even going into the weekend, it was pegged at $130 to $150 before those Thursday night numbers came in. Well, starting Thursday night, not only do we get the initial numbers, but Deadline started specifying that the numbers they were reporting were from their own calculations and not Disney's. I think that Disney's credibility will be hurt by this, with no one from the industry to the media to fans believing any Disney-related headlines unless a third-party source is specifically cited as the cause of the headline. That's going to be a big deal going forward. And I wonder if any third parties that Disney used as evidence for Solo, its strength going into its release, will also maybe be more protective of their own images and not wanting to have maybe been seen like they put out information that might not have been true. We were looking at the empty theaters and we pre-booked our tickets for Solo. We knew something was amiss. But then something else that one of you brought up that I thought was a great point, another great point, was that Disney should consider backing away from Memorial Day weekend. This treacherous holiday weekend has now sunk the Pirates and Alice franchises, plus was a disaster for Tomorrowland as well. Now, also, as I'm sure some of you are pointing out, those are all crap movies. But that means that either the upcoming Aladdin is also crap or really needs to move that release date. In fact, Disney has Memorial Day weekend, for some inexplicable reason, considering what happened to these other movies, booked through 2022. That's shocking. And they should release those dates immediately, because they've got some serious bad mojo. In fact, this has always been a bad weekend for movies, as we've discussed. Rarely does a movie deliver here, and perhaps this should be reserved for, maybe this should be like the first weekend of August, right? For Maverick movies or smaller films that could go big if they're able to break out, right? I would think that maybe that's the correlation should develop. Now, I'll have a complete breakdown of the situation for you Monday at the end of the holiday weekend, when the official, the official numbers won't actually come in until Tuesday morning, but the writing will be on the wall at that point, for sure. Also on Monday, I'll be doing an all Solo live stream on my new Twitch channel at 4 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, where you'll be able to talk to me live about the box office, the future of the Star Wars franchise, and we'll have a spoiler discussion about the movie as well. The link to my Twitch channel is down below in the video description. If you want to see the movie before you have that discussion, now you know to try and go and see it before Monday at 4 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. I hope that you will join me for both the box office report and that live stream on Twitch. But for now, share your thoughts down below, your developing thoughts about this developing story. And of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.